Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Billionaires Chat Show by Indiewood Billionaires Club in association with EFISA. To become an entrepreneur, you must be determined and focused. You must challenge yourself every single day and leave your fears aside. For an entrepreneur, his greatest fear is not trying what he believes in. And once they find the thing they love, they make every possible way to achieve the success. Indiewood Billionaires Chat Show is an exclusive webinar which features the special stories of self-made entrepreneurs who believed in themselves and helped the world to inspire others to dream more, learn more, and become more. Inviting our host of the evening, Dr. Sohan Roy SK, a Forbes-listed entrepreneur and founder chairman and CEO of Aries Group of Companies and founder president of Indiewood Billionaires Club. Dr. Roy has a glittering record of achievements with a rare combination of experience from maritime, visual media, and Hollywood. He's also the concept creator of EFISM, Efficiency Improvement System Management. Thank you, sir, for joining us today. Now, coming to our special guest of the day. He's a leading business tycoon who started his professional journey in engineering and sales and marketing, high-tech filing and packing machinery firm, and soon established Dyson Tech LLC in 1999, and later opened his manufacturing unit in India named Impact Machineries in 2007. He's a pioneer in electronic weighing scales in India and the Middle East, Africa, European countries, and American continents in England. Here is a short video compiling his life journey and achievements.
Mr. Sami Sayed started his career in engineering in sales, marketing, high-tech filling and packaging machinery, and soon established Dyson Tech LLC in 1999. He later established a manufacturing unit in India named Impact Machineries in 2007. As an entrepreneur in this growing industry, he has developed new industrial robotic filling packaging solutions that made him a pioneer in electronic weighing scales and systems in India, Middle East, Africa, European countries, American continents, and England. He is the first outstanding person in India who invented an exceptional German servo measuring device and robotic filling machines. He has expertise in setup turnkey for processing, filling and packaging industries, projects and consultancy, complete setup of industries like shisha, tobacco, food, perfume oil and lubricant, primary, secondary packaging and weighing systems, etc. Not just in engineering industry, he has left his footprint in various fields like sports, politics and charity. He was elected as director of T10 Cricket League for 3 years in UAE and was highly appreciated and awarded for his efforts in 2018. For commendable services to the manufacturing and distribution industry, charity activities and goodwill. Mr. Sayed has received various awards and accolades, including International Youth Icon in 2020 by the United Nations Department of Economic and Social Affairs, Brand Ambassador of Water and Energy Sharjah by Sharjah Chamber of Commerce and Industry Chairman Dr. Rashid Aleem, and more.
Hi, good evening, viewers. Cricket has become the religion of Indians, and UAE has become the paradise of it. IPL is going on, and entire UAE is so thrilled because the finals going to happen. But UAE is more popular about cricket few years back just because of another event in cricket, a more dynamic tournament, that is T10. Those days when T10 was happening, I used to go and watch this event. Sometimes in just 10 hours, they were scoring almost like in a T20 match. Every dot ball was celebrated by the bowling team. For not getting a 4 or 6 out of that. And there was a man behind those events who was the director for almost 3 years in that event. So today he is our guest. Sami, welcome.
Thank you so much.
Sami, whenever I see you, I think about an younger brother, a very dynamic, a naughty younger brother who step into everything, don't spend waste a single minute roaming around from one place to another, getting involved in all glamorous things. If I think about such a young brother, no other face come to my mind except yours.
Thank you, Mr.
So take it as a compliment, actually.
Thank you so much.
Sami, I am totally confused from where to start, because as a techie or as a sportsman or as a glamour field from about Bollywood, should I start, or should I start from politics? So many fields you are into. But now, since it's a cricket season, we will start from the cricket. I believe that you were studying in the same school with Sachin Tendulkar and other things. And if you had focused like Sachin had done those days, you'd have been in the Indian cricket team. How you missed out that chance?
See, the when I started my career in cricket, I was studying in a school called Christian School, which is in Mumbai. And from there, I told my parents that I wanted to be a cricketer. So I have moved my schooling from that school, which is Dr. Antonio De Silva High School, I studied. And then at the early ages, or third grade, I shifted to SVM, Sharda Vidya Mandir, where our senior were great cricket players like Sachin Tendulkar, Vinod Kambli, Ajit Agarkar, Amul Muzamdar. They are the people, those we used to do the cricket practice. And I was an off spinner as well as I was an opening batsman. And I played for a cricket team for a long time, but there are lots of, apart from the cricket, there is lots of other things were involved. So I missed the chance, unfortunately. And then I focused on football. And then I finally decided that leave the sports, because if I don't reach to the next level, then there is no use to make a career on it. So that I don't want to waste my career. So I focused on my studies after that.
So then how do you come to the T10 concept?
Yeah. See, that internal passion of cricket and sports were always there, because I wanted to be a cricketer, but unfortunately, I did not get the opportunity to play for Team India. But that passion, that love towards the cricket, it was always there till I die. So I got an opportunity from our friend circle, and Shajal Mulk, he gave me the opportunity, and he told me that we need the sponsors, and then we need to do the things, many things on that. So based on that, I started working out and it clicked. So I could able to get the sponsorship for the first year. And then he gave me more opportunities for doing something for the cricket. So I did the crowd activation, then more other things also I did it. So this is my career started with T10 for the first year. Then the second year also, with his support, I did a little bit more achievements, and I also got more sponsorship. And this is for the second year. And third year, when I did not find any sponsor, then I sponsored a great event, which was a fabulous event, which was organized by Mohammad Morani and Shajal Mulk. So I sponsored the opening of the third year. So this is how the journey of T10 has started.
And how do you compare the T10 with the T20? How was the experience?
See, basically, the concept is totally unique in T10, because every ball is a person, like, you know, they wanted to hit, because there is only 10 over matches. And the cricket is go so fast, okay, that every person, like every player wants to achieve, every team owner want to win. And it's so happening on that, you know, the concept was a little bit more with a good and innovative idea by Mr. Mulk. He added more entertainment, more masala, and, you know, he made it so happening. So we cannot compare. But if you say, as far as the fun is involved, the speed match, you say, like, you wanted every ball, you want a 6 or 4. That synergy and that energy in the players, it's always there. So the player comes on the ground, he wants to hit. It's not like defeat or something, and it's a big fun. So it's a completely different concept. Whereas T20 is little serious and it's a classical one. But the new concept and new format, which I really appreciate and I like, it's T10.
See, if T10, what I believe is that this T10 can be screened in the theaters, because in 2 hours, the match gets over. So just like a movie, you can create a loyal audience and you can run it as a show, actually. What do you believe that? I like that.
Yeah, that can be possible. But, you know, like there are so other sports are there, like football matches are there. That's for 90 minutes. This also 90 minutes. But the thing, like, you know, the whole day you see the matches, it's like, you know, you get bored, or like, you know, if the player is not playing good, or, you know, you'll not have. But in T10, you can't move your eyes from the ground. You know, you are just waiting. Yes, now 4, 6 are out. That excitement is throughout the match, which is a lovely concept. It is really
if you experience that on a big screen instead of watching in a television, if you watch it in a theater in a big screen, it would be better, no?
Yeah, that's a suggestion. That's a very good suggestion, which I think you yourself can talk to the chairman, as you're a friend of the chairman of T10 Cricket League. So it's a very good idea, actually.
But now, actually, as a cricket fan, how do you see the cricket days in UAE? Because the finals going to happen. After that, T10 is going to happen. So how blessed the UAE cricket fans?
Now, after the pandemic and COVID-19, the situation is changed. The player, the audience cannot go to see the matches and all. So it is little bit of, different level where we cannot have physical movements at the ground and, that such type of things. But still, thanks to the government of UAE, they are allowed IPL to come in. They're screening and they're making the things happening. So I think the new concept will be coming up, and inshallah, if we will be lucky in the month of January, everything gets open, then grounds are open. I think it can fill up the whole crowd and we'll back to life as a sports life, I can say.
What I liked in T10 was you tried to bring so many retired players, also very famous, very branded players. Because it is a rare opportunity to see them playing in front of you again, once again. Will you follow the same pattern in future also?
See, this year, basically, I don't know very much how things are going to move, because now the management is being managed by the chairman and Abu Dhabi government and other people. So I'm for first 3 years, yes, if you ask anything, I can say, but for the upcoming matches, I have started just now working on a few of the things on T10, but I'm not very much involved right now on this system, how it's going to happen and what will be the new concept, because what are the new rules will be implemented during those days on COVID. So we don't know much about it, actually.
Okay, now coming back to our main topic. See, okay, from your school days, you left your cricket dreams, and how was the journey till you started the Dyson, right? So how was the journey towards Dyson?
Actually, since my father was a doctor and he wanted to put me in medical, and I wanted to go in medical, so I was more keen and interested in engineering. So it happened such, I score very less during the grade 12, so that, I will not get the admission in medical. And it happened in that way, I did not get the admission in engineering because of the less score. So I have to do the business management, and then I did my BCom. And after that, once I finished, then, as I told you, the passion and what you want to achieve in life, if you decide, you will do the same thing. So I told my father, even I'm a BCom student, I'm going to join an engineering company. And one day I'll be doing the engineering work. And it was my passion and it was my dream to do. So immediately after the graduation, I came to UAE. And after I came to UAE, I joined a company called Phoenix, where they were selling the weighing scale in Sharjah Free Zone. I worked for 2 years, almost 2 years I worked. And then it happened such the as usual, whatever happens like in UAE, the company got defaulted on the thing. Some people have run away with the check bounce and all that stuff. So the chairman decided to close the company. So I told the chairman that, sir, give me an opportunity. I was very young. I was just 21. So I told him that, sir, give me the opportunity. I will run the show. So there were total 16 employees this time. And then there was a senior manager, general manager. And then everyone was making a joke of me that how young boy can run the company when we cannot, with the experience and all. So they asked me to leave the meeting room because I was not people were not taking me seriously. So I've been to the room of my chairman. He was staying in Grand Hyatt. I still remember. And then I knocked at the door at 12 o'clock night. And I said, sir, I won't talk to you. I said, not again, Sammy, please go. I'm really tired. I won't sleep. I said, no, sir, you have to listen. Give me at least 5 minutes. And then I told him that, sir, see, look, you have already paid the rent for 6 months. You have the goods. You're going to close. There is a car loan. There's so many liabilities. Why don't you give the liabilities to me? And you have still 6 months. And if ever I could not able to fulfill, because engineer product is such, when it is when you're selling it is a high price. But if there is no requirement, it's nothing, because engineering products you cannot use in daily use, So he think over and he said, please, when you finish, already finish? I said, yes. And he said, leave. And then I knew that he's going to give me a call because the offer what I gave him was fantastic. Any person will catch that offer because all the liabilities I was taking on my head. So 5 o'clock morning, I did not sleep that night. 5 o'clock morning, he called me, Sammy, can you come to my room? I said, yeah, sure, I'll come to your hotel. So I rushed over there and then morning he said that, see, it's all your risk. You're a very young boy. You're very much energetic boy. And then I don't want to put you in trouble. But are you sure you're going to take this decision? I'm going to go to the court and I'll transfer the whole company under your name. And no liability will be under me. So I said, I'm okay. So morning 9 o'clock we went. And then he transferred the company. And then I walked in. I still remember the next day I walked into the company as a normal person, like how I used to come as a when I was an employee. So I went and then I told my staff that please vacate, ask the GM to come out. I'll be the first person to get in the company because I own it. So that became very panicking situation. And, you know, the journey which I have started was like unbelievable. And from that time, then what I did, I contacted all my distributor, whatever goods we were having, we sold out all the goods. Okay. And I asked every person to go back home. I canceled everyone. And I started the company. From that time, my journey started. So I own the company. And from that time till now, I'm just working and working on the different level.
What were the activities in that company exactly? What all products?
At time we were into all the weighing equipments and all the weighing scales from the supermarket to industrial scales and all. So we used to have a distributor called Mohsin Haider Darvesh in Oman, and similar one like we started the distribution of weighing scales, the truck scales, and then a platform scale for industrial scales and all. And then my core was like, you know, not the ready-made scales to import from China, but to do the some technical things. So those days, the weighbridge was costing something like 120,000, 130,000 dirham. So people were facing lots of problems, especially the scrap companies. Whenever they used to load the scrap and go to the weighing scales, they used to charge 25 dirham. And, you know, every day they used to have around 30, 40 weighings. So it was very expensive for them. So the first what I did was I used the load cells technology and I made first weigh bridge for 18,000 dirham, which can go 30 ton capacity. And from there, I become very famous in scrap companies and people were coming on, you know. So I started a small fabrication unit. I used very good techniques in the engineering way, which is if I tell any engineer, he said it's impossible. So that techniques I used and I make from 120,000 dirham weigh bridges to 18,000, 20,000 dirhams. And it was my beginning. So then I generated the interest to go more detail, like more deep into the engineering.
I think this is going to be a very inspirational session for everyone, because all the upcoming entrepreneurs who are watching this one, they are looking for people like you who started from the scratch at this young age. At the age of 21, you took such a risk, because normally at the age of 21 nowadays, we all roam around the campuses, enjoy life with parents' money. But at that age, you took one of the biggest challenges in your life. Do you think it was the biggest challenge, or later did you take any other challenge like this?
Actually, you know, the first success of the weighbridges which I did, it was very successful. Then I went to the animal weighing system. So I did one very interesting project for Nadal Shiba. The project was, you know, weighing the animals. So normally they have the horses and camels, which the local people love for their derby and for their races. And they have a very good attachment. So they are very much conscious and very much caring about the animals. So what they eat, what is the weight, weight is losing, weight is gaining. That's basically on that. And the horses, they have the history. Who is the father? Who is the mother? Who win the World Cup? What is the thing? What age, what weight was for the father, what weight for the mother. So I prepared a software. Okay. I put all the data for the mother, all the data for the father. Okay. For the horses. And then I use the science that what weight and what height and what measurement is the healthy horse to win the race and what type of calories it has to be there on the weight basis. So I made a software and I put it all that in. And I said that, okay, fine, it's a magic system which says the future of the horse. And nobody, all the locals were laughing at me. I met one of the sheikh, and he was telling, you are just joking. I said, no, I did it. And you know, when I prepared it, and then I put that horse on that, and it gave the data, and then he took the doctor, and doctor said, wow, this is real. And you know that, and my luck was so good. There was a race was going on, and that horse got win with the chart of calories and all. So then I started the animal weighing system from there. So I was get so much motivated. I thought of doing something else. So there was an induction technology. Till that time, I was already in the next level of packaging. So there was an induction technology used for sealing the caps and all. So I thought of, when we can seal the cap with this technology, why don't we make the cooker? So I was the first guy who went to UK. There was an exhibition called Hanover. There was an exhibition in UK happened. So I went over there. And then I took the, I learned the technology from induction to home appliances, how we can do it. And then there was an exhibition in Hanover, Germany. I was just 22 that time. And then I went with the technology as a prototype. I went to Hong Kong. I developed a stove, which is called Magic Stove. Then I went to China and developed around like 20,000 pieces. So I was not having that much money to even make 20,000 pieces. So I said, okay, fine, we are going to make 3,000 pieces as a sample. I told the Chinese guy, and I want another 17,000 pieces in so much time. And these are the deposits. And then that guy took very seriously, and that took 6 months time to develop. Meantime, I came with the magic store. I went to Sharjah, and then me and my wife have give a demonstration, because the store was cold. The vessel was cold, and the food gets cooked 4 times faster than a normal stove, and only the heat implemented to only to the food. So it become a magic. Like I take the ball up, put the stove, and put the hand in. My hand is not nothing, and the upstairs, like, you know, it's boiling. So it become magic. So then the Baladi of Sharjah, they said, no, there must be some kind of cancer can take place or something. So I have to go through all the laboratory labs and all. I got the certificate. Then I did the exhibition in Saudi Arabia. And there the Prince Talat bin Walid company, and there was a U-Mark TV, Mr. Gandhi. I showed a demonstration, and then I successfully got the order of $1 million there at the age of 21. And that make my life change. Then I went to the Chinese guy. See, the confidence is like crazy. What confidence I used to have. It was completely crazy. You know, I bought 3,000 stoves. I manufactured, but I gave a deposit of 17,000 more, but I don't know whether I'm going to sell it or not, but I knew that I'm going to do it. And with that money, I got it, and we brought the goods, and then we started selling in TV channels, because I don't want it, you know, that every shop should have it. And, you know, I wanted to keep it very exclusive thing, but only the thing, I did not do the pattern. And then I sold all the technology and everything to U-Mark TV, and then I was enjoying money. Then I thought, like, you know, home appliances, I don't want it to get in, because, you know, the complaints will come, the ladies will call, and I don't want that to get in, because my core business on the engineering on the B2B sector. So then I went there, like, you know, I started a company in India, and then so on. I begin with many, many things later on.
So I mean, in your story, a new character came in between. That is your wife. So at what age did you get married?
That's very interesting. Actually, my wife was 14 years and I was 14 years. I met her in Mumbai, and then we were like, we know each other. And then one fine morning, she called me and she said that my papa is taking me to Dubai. And she wanted, like, they're going to fix her engagement or marriage with someone. So you have a high time, and you have to come to Dubai. So then I said, okay, fine. So I came Dubai, and the best part, you know, I took the help of father only. I said, uncle, I got a good job, but the thing is, they want to take the interview in Dubai. So can you arrange the visa? He said, okay. So I paid the visa charges to him. I took his help. I came here, and then I joined Phoenix. I took over Phoenix, and, you know, we went to India. We got married, and we came back here. And so on, the life started, actually.
That was your first smart move, huh?
I don't know, but it's all destiny.
Okay, no, I'm 100% sure that, because everyone curiously looking at how you generate the first fundraising, okay, because your boss gave you a chance with the base, but to run the show you were looking for money, right? So how do you generate the fund to run the first year show?
As a businessman, okay, if you're a real businessman, if you want to do business, you can take a smart move. You don't need funds, actually. As I told you, when I told my boss that, look, you have lots of liabilities, okay? So if you want to fulfill the liabilities, you have to close down the car loans, you have to close down the rents and water, electricity and all. You know, when you close the company, there are lots of NOCs are required. I said, instead of that, and also there was an RBI invoice, which is like, you know, any goods you export out of India, that much money has to come in. So that goods have come on the LC basis. So he has to put a big money because there were some people, those who bonds the check and they run away with the goods. So he has no choice. So again, he was very straight guy, and then he don't wanted to get the cash money and do the things. And also he was very limited choice. And then when I said, okay, fine, whatever goods is left, okay, give it to me within 6 months time, I will return you back. But I could able to sell all the goods within 3 months because I was in sales and I was having the dealer distributor. I said, okay, fine. The distributor, I told that the company is coming to the merge and then merges. And then we have to, we will give you around 20% discount. So I could able to, you know, do some marketing stuff and all. And finally, it happened so that my dealer distributor have supported me. And then they gave the money and I exported. So the money what I got generated, I have to return that money in 6 months. So I have 3 months in hand. So I told my boss, I said, look, boss, I'm going to give you the first lot of the money, because for him, it was something very surprised, because he thought everything is lost, but I'm generating out of his loss. So I said, okay, fine. This is the 50 lakh rupees goods, which I have sold. Okay. These are the money. But you have to promise me that you will give me 1 crore rupees of goods against that, which I'll pay you in 6 months. So I transfer this 50 lakh rupees, 25 lakh rupees, then he sent the goods and another 25 lakh rupees. So I got 1 crore rupees of goods. So now 1 crore rupees with the machinery margins, those days was around 60-80% margin. So already got 80 lakh rupees profit, because before the good comes, I already pre-sold the goods to our dealer distributor. So I did not face any problem as far as the fundraising, because I did it out of nothing. And so this is how my career started.
Your parents did not teach you all these techniques. You had any mentor?
I don't know, but it was the life I started with early ages with one aim, that I have to marry a girl I love. And then after that, you know, when I started, the things have gone open up by itself. And I just focused that what I have to do, and I was keep on going on. So that is the thing. But later on in my life, I met many people, those who have helped me, not financially, but morally. Today also, I get motivated by so many people like you and other friends of us, for which I just see them. I say, okay, fine. When this guy have come out of from such a low level to such a big level, so still there is a lot of time to cover up. So still I feel I'm nothing in front of them. So this is what the mentoring is happening.
See, this is how. As a handsome guy, you always stand with beauty, either with your wife or with a very beautiful car. When did you start loving these luxury cars? When did you get the first luxury car?
My first car was at the age of 25, 20, 26. I bought my first car was actually when I was in sales. My first car was Toyota Corolla, which I drove, I think, 6 months. And then I gave it to my salesperson, because I appointed a salesperson and give it to him. And I bought Galloper. And then 3 months I drove that, and then bought Pajero. So then after, like, we used to go to Oman, set up the things and come back. You know, so that was really good days even in that car. And the 2007, I bought a Cadillac Escalade. Then I thought of, because I was going too much in desert drive and all. And then I bought another Land Cruiser. So that's why the car journey started. But the first car I bought is 2010, the Ferrari. So that was the time I was early 30s. So that was the thing, because I used to always admire the cars in Dubai, like people are going with the Porsche cars, and you know, and I said, okay, fine, I will buy the car of my own money, because early ages in 20s, mostly the parent buy the cars for them. So I said, I will gift myself. So it was December 27th. I told, I went to buy a car. I said, see, tomorrow is my birthday and I want to gift myself. And the guy was really, the salesman was really surprised, and he was laughing that you are gifting yourself, and you have a time limit that I want by 12 o'clock, December 28th, I want a car. So this is how I have, my first car came in my life. And after that, I bought lots of cars, and that is the thing.
What was the reason for you to jump into the Bollywood? Because the rest of the photos, you're always with the Bollywood stars. You had any dream to act in any movie or something that drag you to Bollywood again and again?
No, it's not that way. I was very young that the time I used to go with my father. So I was 14 and Sonu Nigam was, I think, 18 years or something. I got a picture still. My father was a health officer of Mumbai, and he used to be invited by the Bollywood people. They used to do lots of programs in Mumbai, that is BMC, Mumbai Municipality. So we used to invite, like those days, Raveena Tandon and even Aishwarya Rai, all Amitabh Bachchan and all used to support a lot. So that time I used to meet, and I have generated some interest. And after a period of time, when I got an opportunity, I invested in one of the TV serial with one of my friend. And then I more generated the things. And then I did one event with one of the very big guy from Bollywood. And this is how I generated little interest. But I never tried to be a hero, or I wanted to be do act. Because I believe that every person who takes birth in this world has a reason. And I feel my reason is engineering. My reason is to do some other activities. But yes, there is a passion for sports, Bollywood. When you come to one level, you know, sports, Bollywood and all that stuff come by itself. So you don't need to get in. They come to you, actually. Yeah.
Actually, you're more known as an engineering expert. You invented many things, especially yes. In the packaging thing. Actually, you made an international stamp. Actually, very rarely such kind of the products with international quality, especially with the German quality, getting produced in India. Can you elaborate something on that one? What was the invention? How you maintained the quality? What exactly is this? Because our viewers are not at all aware about what is this packaging industry.
Yeah. See, basically, I got the opportunity. I wanted to open after this development and all early ages. I wanted to be a manufacturer, because I remember I made one first filling machine in 2001. There was a company, they wanted to fill the sugar, but they wanted to fill the sugar in the paper pouch. And that paper pouch machine was costing something like $250,000, which is almost a million dirham. And he told me that, Sami, I have a budget of 25,000 dirhams. So it's impossible. So I thought of, okay, fine, let's begin the some semi-automatic machine for SME industries. So I developed on the load cell basis with a vibration. I made first filling system, copied to the principle of that particular machine, which is almost a million dirham. So that concept, I brought it into the weighing industry. And then from the weighing scales, I started making the packing machine. And then I thought, okay, fine, when I can do this, then I can even do much more if I get a proper setup. So there was a company called Europack in India. So that company was a small company, not very big, but the filling line, what they were doing, it was fantastic. So I went and they were not doing well. So somehow I got connected to one of my friend, one of my customer. And then he told me that, Sami, we want to make the lubricant filling machines, but the budget is, we have a very limited budget. And then I was not having a head and tail knowledge on the liquid industry. I was doing the sugar weighing scales and other stuff like granule. But so liquid was something first for me. Then I told him, okay, fine, I will take over the company and let's do the things. So the director have charged me those days 5 lakh rupees to just show me how to the design. And the design was really not very well. It was not very good. So when we developed the machine, we faced lots of problem in the liquid. There is a leakage and all that stuff. And I was worried that my first thing, you know, I'm failing. And I was worried that it's my first business. I wanted to be manufacturers before I start. I'm seeing my end. Then I went to, as I told you in the earlier just before also, I went to Hanover Fair. And I met one of the guy from Shell Petrol Pump. They were making the servo technology for filling the fuel. And they were doing the uranium filling for power plants. So I thought of using that technology into our filling system. The same way I did it when I was 21, the induction. So I tried my luck here also. So I told them, okay, fine, I will pay you 50 lakh rupees. And can you do the pattern? He said, no, we have already signed the agreement. We cannot give it. They will make the case on me. I said, okay, I'm paying you for new development. So take the 50 lakh rupees and develop something for me, which can be easy for me with the same concept. So once they developed for me, I brought it in and I worked very hard. And then I successfully made one first filling machine. Then when I saw the machine was written Europack, I said, I made this. Though the technology is from Europe and I developed so much, but at the end of the day, I'm making this machine in India. So immediately I decided to make the name of my company Indian Packaging, but Indian Packaging was too big, like Indian Express, Indian Railway. So I said, okay, fine, let's make it short. So I picked Inpack. And Inpack, it was the, then my CA told me, sir, you cannot put Inpack, you should put it Impact, IM. I said, no, I want to keep it Inpack because it is Indian Packaging. And then I put my logo and my name on the machine. And I sold to one of the big company here and it got clicked. After that, I think almost every company of lubricant in UAE are using Inpack machine as filling line. So this is how I started developing these servo flow devices. And then later on, there was a labor problem. Those days, the visa was not easy accessible. And also I said, okay, fine. Why don't I go in robotics? So then I started replacing the manpower to the machine, and then I make all automatic machines. So my journey started actually from here, and I got a good knowledge. I learned so many things on liquid technology, and this is how I started with.
Yeah, someone told me your product is supposed to be the India's number one. Is it true?
Basically, when you say the design size, like, you know, design type, and our machine does not require actually the spare parts. You know, it's all the spare parts are available. Normally, you know, when you buy a machine, even you buy a small TV, if it does not working, it does not work, you will go to the service center. Service center people will say, okay, fine, this part you have to change, this you have to do. But in our machine, each and every part is available in the hardware. Okay, wherever you go, international hardware shops, you just buy it and fix it. So we become popular. And I never, because I don't believe in the service charges. I believe that the company is growing. This is how like perfume industry, like 80% perfume companies are using my machine. I believe that if a small company is using our machine and he gets order on time and delivery on time, he will grow. And when he grow, since I'm helping people, that they will come back to me. Then I started the concept of people, those who don't have money to start the business, or somebody wants, he has a good experience in perfume industry and he want to put a factory. I say, okay, fine. Look, I'll set up the processing line. I'll give you the filling machine, packing machine and all. And you pay me in 1 year time in installment. So, but your focus should be sales and the quality of product. You promise me this and I will promise you to give the machine. So that way till now, from 2000 till now, I think more than 3,000 company I have set up. So I become popular. But the thing is, like, it cannot be in Bollywood and other industry, you know, you get come to the limelight. But when you say engineering, like if I tell you Dabur, so okay, fine, it's a brand. But if I tell you some other company, like XYZ company, you will not know. But you know by the name, by the brand. Okay, but that brand, actually there is a manufacturer or somebody else who is making brand for somebody. You see, so we engineering companies will never come in limelight, but actually we are there in day-to-day life of everyone, from the toothpaste till the hair oil to your washing powder, or you just name it, your petrol, your oil, your engine, everywhere this packaging and filling is a very essential and very important part. So this is how the things happen in our engineering industry.
I know you are very much into robotics, so to reduce the manpower. But still, I believe we have more than 1,000 employees altogether. How many employees do you make use of your services altogether?
See, basically, we have a weighing scale company in India where Mr. Rajesh Bhatwa is taking care of it. And there at the factory, 1,200 people are there on the weighing equipment. Then we back home in engineering and robotic system where we make the automatic machine, packing machines and all, we have 250 employees. Here we have almost a staff of 40. So, but we have suppliers, we do the job work outside and all. If that, the whole strength we will calculate is huge. So it is not like, you know, we make all machines ourselves. We make some machine we get it done from outside, some machine is a part of the our, even we buy the machine from competitors. So we make the complete line. So this is how things happen. But when we say the new development, servo technology and replacement of manpower, like cartoning machine and all, we need lots of skilled people to work for us. And when I started with weighing scale, then we started with granule food packaging, then we started with perfume, then we started with, now we are working very good in shisha, hookah, tobacco business, cigarette business. So we don't only sell the machines. So in this last 20 years, working with so many people and working with this all products, I myself can develop anything. So we do the consultancy because I'm little young, as you say, like a consultant. So I don't call me, I don't put myself into that, but I give the free advice. We do complete know-how. How to prepare, like you say that I'm interested, you have a passion of perfume, I'm interested, I have money, but I don't know how to make it. So we come to the picture, we say, okay, fine, this is the technology, these are the processing lines, these are the things, including the supply of manpower who will make such kind of products, and then the filling, packaging and bottling. So we give an entire turnkey project for a person who is interested to be a manufacturer. So this is how I worked out.
Great. I say the IndiaWoods vision is $1 equal to 1 rupee. To make it happen, we need to fill our economic bucket. We need to plug the drain holes. But that is what you are doing, because you make use of Indian manpower, Indian raw materials, and you create a product and you sell it internationally and bring the foreign money. What exactly? Because other than this, what are your contribution to Indian economy?
See, basically, as I told you before, that I was working for Make in India program. We got lots of foreign investors to India. And we wanted that India should become a manufacturing hub. People are going to China. I want that they should come to my country to get the things done. So we'll supply them the infrastructure and all same time. We did lots of promotions to get a foreign company. And also the company, those who are in India, I don't call any of the competitors because all are my friends, and they every competitor is like me. That's the thing. Otherwise, you know, in our industry, competitors, like, they don't, if somebody is coming there, he will turn the face. Where else? I have changed the whole concept. So even in UAE, I just call any of my competitors, hey, look, I'm in trouble. Can you help me? He will say yes, because this is the relation what I have built up. So in India, what I did, a few of my competitors, I have made joint ventures from Germany, Italy, all these places to develop and make the new things. So in that, I never thought, okay, fine, he's growing, and then because of his growing, he will take my sales. No, I never take that, because sales and the, we call in Muslims, rizq. So when we get a rizq, it is decided by our God, Allah, that he will get it or he will not get it. So our duty is to just do the deeds and forget the results. Results, if it has to come, it will come by itself. So with that concept, you know, we did lots of mergers. We did lots of economy for exports. Like, you know, we did lots of, we give lots of platform for exports for many products. Whether you talk about the machine or even the products. So this is what we did it, and still the work is going on. So now this, because of the COVID, there are lots of things are in export and lots of things have been stopped. But I think from January onwards, the Indian government is taking really good initiative, so export and to make the economy more strong.
See, so from your point of view, from your experience, what is the guideline you want to give to the Indian industrialist to make some changes in their sector to improve the economy of India? And also, what is your advice to the government also? What all things to be taken care of by the government to support the investors?
See, actually, according to me, if the government put the for the raw material which we import to make it finished goods, they should give some subsidy. And for exports, we should also get supported. Supported in the sense is not, they should make the procedure more easy. And I think that will really do the good things. And whatever the government promise to the foreign companies, they should fulfill on time. So that way, I think India become a number one exporter. And same time, the infrastructure for the manufacturers, what government has to do it, they have to do it. They have to come like in Dubai, mashallah, like they have free zone. The infrastructure is so beautiful. They support the manufacturers. The similar support, if we get in India, we can do something fantastic. And my suggestion to the our brothers, our competitors, and the same industry of engineering, that if we do the quality products and we control the prices, because, you know, there is no control on the prices in India. One person is selling for example, 10 lakh rupees. Another person is selling for 5 lakh rupees. It depends on the need, how much needy the person is. So that has to stop this, the rule of the pricing. Like we have fixed pricing rules in India. When you sell it in India, that these are the MRP prices. The similar one, it has to be there in export also. But same time, they have to check the quality, because we can't take a risk of spoiling our country name more. Otherwise, you know, we will be very much back, because we need export to support our people, those who are lost the job, those who are into trouble. So financial troubles. So big companies are getting closed down in India. There are lots of things are happening at that moment of time. Instead of criticizing our own people or the government is busy with other activities, they have to more focus on the economy and how to grow the economy. People like us, and like we have so many Indian people, those who really want to do so many things in India, so that, you know, we can do exports. The more export we do, the more the economy will get strong. There is no other solution than this, because we don't have any big natural resources of petrol or oil where we can do the export and make money. What we have is the grains, fertilizers, and the exports. Export, you can say garment, or you say engineering or anything. But export today is the only solution to increase the economy of India. This is what I want to say.
See, the last expo was happened in Italy, and you were a part of that one. And now this year's expo in Dubai got postponed for next year. But why this kind of expos are not happening in India to attract the world industries?
Yeah. See, 2015, I was being selected as a delegation to represent India Expo 2015 in Italy, Milan. There I saw the beautiful way of displaying the country. Like Slovenia, they made an electrical plane. Okay, they said like, okay, fine, we charge the plane and these other things and all. They're talking more on the technology. They're talking more on this. Whereas the UAE have displayed a fantastic module of their country. So this is a promotion. The expo is an exhibition where you promote your country, okay, internationally. Okay. It was unfortunate because of Corona, we could not able to do it in UAE. Otherwise, we used to have, we have a very big Indian pavilion, which says about India, technology, culture, and all that stuff, where Piyush Goyal was heading. So I met him. We have a long discussion on that. And the development of this one was fantastic. I was a part of that project for at the initiate stage. If we can do it in India, then in India, we have to make the big base. Okay, we required lots of money for that. And again, the public should support, and also the government should support. But the unfortunate things in our country, if such thing happen, there is also negativity activity also happens. So So that is one of the reason we are not actually prepared for it. But if we do it like our Prime Minister Narendra Modi did Gujarat Vibrant, it was a fantastic to promote India. Such events and such programs, if we do it, I think we are already number one because we are Indians. So I feel that we are number one. But we can become more best and more better only a few things if we change in India. So I think it should happen. The expo should happen.
You were quite famous in UAE from long back. In 2008 itself, I still remember in Khalid Times, there was a big article about you. But irrespective of all these things, you get into controversies also. What is your say on that?
See, this is a part of life, I can say. Khalid Times wrote an article on me as a diversified businessman. Because in 2008, I was in properties, I was in construction, where I was doing the Hamriya Phase 2 in the name of Phoenix Electromech. And then I was in the engineering and all. So they were just wanted to take an interview. They wrote very nice. But you know, what you dream, what you want to do in life, it is not necessary that all time you are successful. My electromechanical company got closed down due to some issues happened, and the market fell down in 2010. My property, which I started investing, it did not work out. So, but alhamdulillah, even though I lost lots of money, whatever money I made it in engineering, I wanted to put it in other businesses, and other business did not do well. So, and many times I fell down, and again I fell down. That was a part of life. But I never gave up. That's only the thing. And when you say about controversy is something, you know, I'm involved in many charity organizations in India. Then in our Islamic culture program, we are there. So every time when, you know, when there is a group of people with a different mentality, okay, say they will always do the negativity on you. Okay, so but how you come out from that controversy is the beauty. Only the best part is like you don't do anything wrong. Okay, and God will never do wrong with you. You don't harm anybody. God will not harm you, you anytime. And when you are in trouble, you help other people, you are in trouble, you'll come out. So these are the basic fundas, you know, if you follow, I think things go better. Even people joke on you, don't care, because you know internally what you are. Because there is a word called in Hindi, kisi ke bolne se you will not change, kisi ke bolne se aap badloge nahi, aur kisi ke bolne se aap bade nahi ho jaoge. Whatever you are there. So, kisi, yani, you know, the respect, what you earn is for yourself. No one on the earth can give you respect and take the respect. It is you who maintain it. It's you how you earn it. So, I'm happy in my life. So I don't care the controversy, but I don't fall something illegal activities, or you can say something where people say point on you. That is not there. That is the honesty what I have come out always with the controversy.
Yeah, it's true. To become a real good businessman, you should experience the faults also. And that way, actually, your career is started by at the age of 21. That itself is a record. Then you went through all these things and you proved yourself as you are going to be a gem in the business field, because you experienced everything, ups and downs you felt. And I appreciate your contribution to the NGOs, actually, because I still remember when IndieWood started the talent hunt in UAE, you were the first one came forward and asked why you are not participating me in your venture. So I was surprised, because normally the other way it happens. We need to approach the sponsors and ask, okay, you should support the event. This is for a good cause, to identify the young talents, upcoming talents. But you are the first one came forward and said, why you are not involving me? Is it the same way you are doing your all charity works?
See, it is not about charity. It is the concept. The concept without, you know, for talent and people take lakhs of rupees. What you are doing is something fantastic, Umesh Roy. You are putting your from your pocket, you are paying for everything. You are a real, I can say, you are the real kingmaker. You are hunting the talent with your own money. Okay, that is a good cause. So joining a good cause is like, I wanted to. It's my passion. I love to. Because whatever you are doing it's something different. And then I saw such a big event. I remember still when you were in Hyderabad, there were hundreds of volunteers. You are giving the speech and putting them here and there. Somebody's going to how to manage the celebrity and all. And they're all youngsters from the college, from the school and all. That I was just admiring you. That time I reached over there, but hardly we know each other. So I said, wow, this is the guy who is really doing something for the community. This is really, he's a kingmaker. Then I thought, look, like, you know, if you're doing it with your capacity, you're doing such a big thing with your money, with everything, with your passion. So I thought of, why don't I join you as a helping hand? So we can bring the real Bollywood people. We can bring the real tycoons, those who are like me. The people I know in Bollywood, they're not necessarily that all Bollywood people or Bollywood the artists are wanted money. But same time, they also, you know, few of them also wanted to promote. They wanted to do some contribution to the society, to do the things. That's why I said, okay, fine. I wanted to join you and I wanted to become your helping hand to take this Indiewood to the next level, which is a fantastic concept. So I got motivated by seeing you and your activities.
Thank you. Thank you. Sami, we are all going through a very bad phase. The entire world is going through a very bad phase due to COVID. I'm sure that you're also affected with this one and your entire industry is affected. How do you manage to come out of that and how is going to be the recovery?
See, the first, the lockdown started, everyone was so panicked. People were wearing the whole dress, COVID dress with gloves, masks and sprays and all. It was so scary. Even my house, you know, my wife, my kids were so scared that anyone was pressing the bell. Everyone get scared, you know, maybe the one of the COVID patients is at our home. That moment of time, I said, if every person will be locked down, every person is in inside the house, it's not going to work out. So I feel that, you know, the essential people like the people, those who are in medical industry and pharmaceutical industry, they have to be come out and they have to do the duties. Then why don't we also support them? So I took the permission from the police and then I started helping the people, those who are making the sanitizer, because there was a huge shortage of sanitizer and disinfectant products. So there in the lockdown, I set up total 28 companies in 4 months. Every businessman, every person who wanted to, because they had nothing to do much. So their permission was granted for making sanitizer, masks and all. So there was a few new company have come in Jabal Ali in masks. So they were into a different product. And when they import the machine by air, they don't know how to run the machineries. So me and my team were working for almost 18 hours and we were completely in lockdown. We worked. And there, when I was going through this phase, I was the road was empty and all. The same time, I was feeling that, you know, how people are surviving that way. Because the rich people, they can stock. The poor people cannot stock. Then me and my wife have decided to help people, because here, at least in UAE, they're blessed. The government is taking care. People are taking care. But back home in India, people were also scared. And same time, the police was so strict. And then my employees, they called me and they said, sir, we don't have food and we cannot go out and all. And then we decided, okay, fine. We took a huge grain lot. And then I started, me and my wife started buying it and then start packing it, because we have our own packaging. So we started distributing and it was very small. We started with like very small amount of 200,000 dirhams, which is 45 lakh rupees. And then the people like us have started supporting us and then reached to the next level. So this pandemic time, we saw few people, not few, there are too many people were helping each other as a human. Now today the condition is so bad because of the lockdown. Still there is a lockdown in India. The business has got closed. The restaurants are not there. So this is a very hard time. But this time, I was thinking that if we can join hands, we should not feel that he's bad, he's good and all. Join hand and help each other. I think we can overcome. Otherwise, we are going to yet to see the disaster. Even the everything, the lockdown will be open, but the businesses, the restaurant business and the poor people, those who are already in suffering, will never come out of it. So I think the government also need to take the initiative, and also the business people like us, like you, and our friends, also need to think over the society and community. Because today, if we think that only we are okay, fine, we are good, we are happy, we have food to eat, we have nice cars to drive and partying, everything. If you focus only on that, then you know what? One day we will come on to the same level because we are interconnected with the human. So if you don't get the servant at your place because they cannot survive back home, they have to leave, then who will do the job for us? So I think we need to support. And this is a time where the support to each other should take place. Otherwise, everyone will be in trouble.
Now we are coming to the last part of our session. So what would be your vision for the next 5 years? What is your planning like?
See, first, this year we need to complete. Only 1 month left. This year we need to, somehow we need to manage it. But upcoming years, we are actually planning to go in education sector, where with a new concept, the way we did the concept for the machineries and engineering, the same way I wanted to come into education sector. I'm planning to give the practicals. Normally, when a child get educated, and then he look for a job and he do the like it's not going to happen. I wanted to come up with something which, you know, with the studies, the person should become a skill. Until the time he become a graduate, he's already a skilled person to manage that, whether it's a computer science, whether it's an operator of machineries, whether it's a robotic. This is one of the idea. Second thing, we have planned to come in manufacturing ourselves, because before all these days, I was thinking that if I start manufacturing, then my customer will feel overwhelmed. They will feel the... they don't want to buy from competitor. But after COVID, I feel that even if I put the production, I can put more people for the work, and we can do the betterment. And more I'm focusing on the manufacturing sectors now. And in UAE also, there are lots of people, those who were doing the service, and then they realized that they can lose the job any moment of time in such conditions. So they also come up, they wanted to start their own production, own manufacturing and all. So I wanted to help everyone to whatever their dream, whether they want to come into food business, whether they want to come in tobacco business or perfume business or chemical business, I can give them a setup. I can show them how to do the manufacturing. I'll support them. So more and more manufacturing company I wanted to develop so that UAE can become a manufacturing hub of Middle East. Same vice versa, I want to do it in India. And this is my dream to begin with as a new life, I can say. Because after COVID, I feel that I'm living a new life because things have completely, drastically changed.
I know that you have some plan with politics also. Tell me the truth.
No, politics, I said that politics is good if you are into development of you know, society. But now I feel that we need to make a, first of all, we need to make a stable government, okay, with the proper motive. Because see, religion is the thing. You feel it for yourself and your society and all. And we do have respect for all the religion. But the first thing what we need to take care of is the human. If there is no human, then who will pray? So more than religion, humanity is there, which we need to respect. And then every religion is important for us because we are human. So you respect human, automatically you respect the religion. So that concept, if we come, I think there is a word for politics, or all the politicians, those who are filling their pocket for their self, will know where, and then every person will be equal in our country. So I lost completely interest in politics, but yes, I wanted to work for the people if I get an opportunity, but not as a politician, as a social worker.
Okay, what is your advice to or guidance to the upcoming entrepreneurs? Very load of youngsters are watching this program.
See, I don't want to advise anyone because I'm not a professor, I'm something very big in the things, but yes, I did lots of achievement in the terms of manufacturing, you say. My suggestion to them is that whatever you like, a person who likes perfume, okay, and he's interested, or he's a sales manager, or he's a person who is having a little bit knowledge, but he's having an interest to become a manufacturer. Yes, they should come up. They should come up with a small thing and they should go for a manufacturing. So similar for the food. I have set up some few companies in UAE. I cannot name them, but the companies, like, you know, they are operating from home, actually. The ladies, those who are at home and they have nothing to do, they are making bakur and they're making a small perfume and giving to the companies. They are putting their brands and selling it. So that concept is, the people are already doing it. They do this. These ladies and these people are not even the, they're not even having a knowledge on business, but they are the manufacturers. So this small manufacturing, you know, when they take place. So my advice to the people over here, like, you know, if you can focus more on the manufacturing and more for the innovative idea, I think this is the time to come out and then, you know, need to start.
Samay, we have a few questions from our viewers also. Lakshmi, can you please look into that?
That was an inspiring session. And one question, how do you define success as an entrepreneur?
This is a good one. But see, you focus on your job, okay? And you don't run for the money. That is number one. You do for doing doing for your satisfaction, you know. Then you keep on going on the how I started. I never wanted to be a businessman. I just focused that I want to finish this project. I want to do this. When I become a businessman, how I have come out, I myself does not know. So focus is the part will take you to the success.
That's great. There's one more question. Has being an entrepreneur turned you into a better person?
That is nothing to do with entrepreneurship, but a better person, a good person is the inner feelings for others. And if you feel that people like you, so that is a quality. And even you bring a small smile on the face of others, okay, and because of you, the person is getting happy and giving a smile, that means you can see yourself as a good person.
So I think we have covered the questions.
Yes, Sami, thank you very much. Because it was a wonderful session.
Thank you so much.
If 1 hour is not enough to interview you, at least 2 hours secure. Because I am 100% sure that we haven't covered many areas of your interest. But fortunately, we have a time restriction. Next time, we will talk in detail. And
thank you.
Once again, thank you very much for sharing your experience and sparing your time. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, bro. Thank you so much for giving such a good opportunity. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mrs. Sami and Dr. Roy, for such a lively discussion. I'm sure our audiences must have got really inspired. We shall be back again soon with yet another interesting life journey of a self-made entrepreneur. Till then, stay safe and see you soon.